I will start very much sort of bringing us to that piece and the human side of what the sustainable goals really mean and what is the financial modeling really aiming to kind of lead into. So India has one of the highest number of out-of-school girls anywhere in the world. We have the highest number of child brides anywhere on the planet, and also the highest number of women and girls in sexual and other forms of slavery. This obviously is, when it comes to gender, India pretty much is at the epicenter of a lot of the really poor gender indicators. In India itself, we have over 3 million girls that are out of school. More than 40% drop out before the fifth grade. Only 1 in 100 girls makes it to class 12. So what is it that we do? So I founded Educate Girls around 10 years ago to specifically look at this problem around girls' education. And I wanted to, I know that because the problem is so big, I wanted to create a solution that was scalable and high impact and low cost. And because the problem is highest in rural, tribal, remote areas, very difficult areas to work, that's where we actually built the model. So to kind of just explain what we do, I wanted to walk you through the story of Jyotsna, a little girl in Pali district in Rajasthan. She's 9 years old, she gets up at 5 a.m., she cooks, she cleans, she looks after her siblings, then she takes the goats out for grazing. And in the afternoon, that's where she will probably have lunch, just sitting in the field somewhere, eating a chapati and a little pickle with the goats around. Now, when you look at that picture of Jyotsna, you can almost map her entire future. She doesn't go to school, there is no learning outcomes for her. She will be married the minute she hits puberty and gets her period. 68% of the girls in Rajasthan are child brides and 15% married below the age of 10. So this is, it's not that she will be an exception, it almost be. And Jyotsna, because she will marry early, she will have her children early, will be more likely to die in childbirth. Her children will probably not, be immunized. And the whole cycle of poverty just sort of continues. So what do? We find a village-based volunteer called Team Balika. Balika just means the girl child. And so it's a team that we create at a village level for girls like Jyotsna. And this team, Team Balika members, we have 8,000 currently on the ground at the village level. They go door to door and they find every single girl like Jyotsna. Once they find Jyotsna, they convince her parents to bring her back into school, enroll her, and then come into the government schools to actually make sure that she's learning and she's retained. So the picture you see there is of Deepika, who is our volunteer at Jyotsna's village. And Deepika went, convinced her parents, got her enrolled, talked to the community about the importance of girls' education, and then finally now comes in 3 times a week to teach and make sure that girls like Jyotsna and the boys in the classroom are learning. So what does it really take? We conduct a door-to-door survey across all of our geographies. Just to give you an idea of the scale, last year we knocked on 2.1 million households in rural and tribal India to find girls like Jyotsna who were not going to school. Once we find them, we work with the community to bring them back and to enroll them into the school system. To date, in the last 10 years, we have enrolled over 150,000 girls that were out of school like Jyotsna and brought them back into the education. We work a lot with parents, with community members. A lot of areas where we work, the prevailing mindset is that a goat is an asset and a girl is a liability. And it's really at the heart of it is about changing that. Why should I educate her? She's just going to get married. What is it in for me? All of those gender barriers really have to be worked on. And also orienting the schools. When I started working, only 40% of the schools had a girl's toilet. Nobody thought that a girl might need a separate toilet to be able to. But now we're seeing a lot of change. By bringing that gender sensitization, about 80-95% of our schools do have a separate toilet. And then finally, bringing in learning, pedagogy, classroom sessions to really up the learning levels, and that's for both boys and girls. Once you're in the school and the classroom, it's about equity and it's about making sure that all children are learning. So it's really a systemic reform model, and it's not a parallel delivery system. Our growth, 10 years ago, I started with a 50-school pilot in Rajasthan, and today when the schools open, we will be at 20,000 schools. Rajasthan and MP. And we're working in some of the toughest areas like Chhabua and MP, Alirajpur. So very, very remote areas where the problem is the most. And our aim is that by next year, we will be in 27,000 schools serving around 2.5 million children. So it's been very, very rapid growth and scale. We're seeing very high impact with our work. But what really kept me up at night when you run an organization such is, you know, when I get to the 2 million, 2.5 million, or the 3 million at Jyotsna, am I still having the same value add? How do I know that my quality doesn't dilute by the time I scale to such a massive geography? And this is something that really kind of, and one of the things that I came across was a sort of payment by results. So when you tie money to outcomes, and I thought, oh my God, that would be one clear way for me to know that when I'm at the 3 millionth or the 4 millionth child, that I'm still having an impact. If I could do that, I could create an organization that has delivery to impact in its DNA. And it was with that that we actually started the journey to think about how can this really happen. It was the genesis of the world's first development impact bond, which is a payment by results contract, and I'll get into the details of that. So this is the first DIB. So in the US and UK, they've done social impact bonds. In India, at that point, nobody was even ready to listen to us. It took me 3 years to go on roadshows to try and convince people to come together to actually pilot this. So I'm saying this because it is a really tough journey to try and do something which is, out of the whole general social sector working of it. But after 3 years, we were able to put together a transaction, which is a development impact bond. It's a 3-year pilot, and it covers 166 schools where we are working. And these are normal government schools in rural areas, but where our intervention is being held. And there's another 166 regular government schools which are using, what we're using as control to kind of see how our impact is versus a regular. It covers 15,000 children over 3 years. And this one is being held in Bhilwara in Rajasthan. The payment triggers are on two outcomes. One is around learning. So when children move up the learning test for literacy and numeracy. So it's a basic test around literacy and numeracy, saying if a child fluent in Hindi, in English, and then in maths to have basic numeracy skills. The minute it's tested, then there's a payment trigger. And when you find an out-of-school girl like Jyotsna, you bring her into school and it's verified by a third party, then there's a payment. So actually, from the SDGs, those are the two indicators that were picked up. One was enrollment of out-of-school girls, which goes to gender equity and also the education goal. And the second was learning outcomes. And this is for boys and girls. So that's where it is. The entire transaction total, the budget is around $300,000 over 3 year period. And that's because our model is a very, very low-cost model. So even though this transaction is small in terms of service delivery cost, it's the largest in the world currently in terms of number of beneficiaries. And that's, I think, just the cost dynamics in India. So Educate Girls in this transaction is a service provider, so we actually execute on the ground. We have ID Insight, which is a third-party evaluator that comes and checks very rigorously to around 99% accuracy all of our results. And then once they check it, then it goes to SIF, which actually pays for the outcome. We as an NGO, we're registered as an NGO, we do not have any working capital, so therefore UBS Optimus Foundation stepped in to be our investor. So that's kind of the cycle. It's a 3-year transaction. We've just completed second year of execution, and the third year will begin now when the schools start in July. So the second year results are not out, but just based on your one result, we had enrolled 44% of the out-of-school girls identified, and we have performed 30% higher than regular government schools in terms of learning. And this is through a community-based volunteer. So it's also about building community ownership. So just taking somebody from the village, we were able to show this impact. Based on year one results, our investor was on track to receive 40% of the investment back. So we're seeing that not only in terms of social impact, but even from the investor side of it, it's showing a really strong direction in terms of being able to meet both of those goals. And the second year results will be out around July or August. again, very hopeful that we will really be able to meet our social impact goals and for our financers to be able to recover their money and be able to make it better. So I think the question that was posed to me was, can SIBs, DIBs, and payment by results kind of financial tools really expedite the SDGs? I sincerely believe that they do. Running an NGO, it has changed the way that I work. You know, NGOs work on a very like input-output mechanism. We'll do the activity and abuse means that change kind of happen. I believe that the for-profit sector has a great efficiency indicator in profit. You're not making a profit, you go out of business. In a lot of NGOs, we can keep existing for 80, 100 years, even if we're not having any impact on the ground, as long as we're good at fundraising. There is no efficiency indicator in the social sector, per se. But having this sort of outcomes-based approach is a really good efficiency. So if I'm not delivering for girls, for educated girls on the ground, I should also be asking. But what it does is it's made us much more focused on the barriers and enablers to scale an impact. So I'll give you an example. Because there's money tied to each enrollment that we make, we've had to think very deeply and collect a lot more data into what is it that triggers the mindset change for the parents. So for example, we now know that if a girl is 11 or 12 years old and out, or let's say she's 7 years old and out of school, I have an 85% chance that I can convince her parents to send her to school. The minute she's 8 years old or 9 years old, for each year, that percentage goes down by about 15%. And that's really important for us. So by the time she's 11 or 12, I barely have a 20% chance that I can enroll her. So it's great for us because now we realize that we've got to act early. Like, just don't wait. Like, if you can get her at the age of 6, 6 and a half, we have to enroll her then, because then otherwise, so action, the way we design our programming, all changes based on what we're seeing on the ground. Second, what is it? We realize that if we do a behavior change, maybe 5,000 people come, everybody fills out a survey saying, great, girls' education is very important, but we don't actually see them enrolling their daughters. So we then try to test a lot of different mechanisms, and we realize that neighborhood meetings, where you're actually pressuring smaller communities, actually lead to higher outcomes. So it's stuff like that that we've really kind of learned that it helps us do our work better. Funding is so much better when it's outcomes-based. It's multi-year. It's not restricted to your line item variances of how many meetings did you do. It's not input-based. It's very much based on outcomes. So it's much more strategic money. It's much more money enabling the problem solving rather than simply delivering of an activity or an input. So I think if SDGs, if we have to reach them and if that it has to be accelerated, then this is a mechanism that we have to kind of adopt on a larger scale. However, there are some things that I would like to bring out that I think we have to be careful of that we're learning. One is like who sets the outcome? So we can't have bespoke outcomes out there that people investors are putting money in, which is why in our transactions they are aligned clearly to the SDGs and the indicators in the SDGs. Otherwise, you have all kinds of bespoke outcomes, and there may be a lot of perverse incentives that get set up with that. So one example of perverse incentives is I get paid only to enroll an out-of-school girl, that's a seven-year-old girl. But I know that if I prevent and if I can get a six-year-old into school, she won't actually become a dropout. But I don't get paid for that. So there's a perverse incentive saying, should I wait till she turns seven, is then qualified, and then so then a payment trigger. So you have to really think deeply and thoughtfully about the design that you're not creating perverse incentives for communities on the ground. I think it is ground realities. And again, I think it's a great tool in our arsenal, in kind of financial mechanisms, to try and accelerate progress. And the reason we do this, all of this, is because when Jyotsna goes to school, we know that she will marry later. She will have her children later. She will be less likely to be beaten, less likely to be trafficked. Her children will be 40% more likely to be immunized. For each year of schooling, her family income will increase by 10%. Jyotsna is the biggest asset we have. The goat is just a goat.
Thank you, Sakina.